Last time I spoke with you was on Star FM.
Exactly, that's true. Real. That is true. That's
and to
like
see my former producer
ago.
Too with a pot belly now, Sadiq,
he's dropping
it's a whole
money.
Good thing. Yeah, he was a good producer. For two yeah. years we worked together.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I remember.
Was 2009,
I remember.
Right?
I believe.
Yeah, yeah, yes. I remember. Solid, solid guy. I mean, what... One thing that I don't miss is that the African history class.
Yeah.
And I've always wanted an opportunity to ask, what motivated that show?
I'll give credit to two people. One from multimedia here, Echiquam. Mm-hmm. And then this guy at Happy FM, Dr. Khan.
Okay.
One day he just teased me and said, instead of sitting on the radio and insulting all these people all night, all day.
Yeah.
Why don't you channel the energy into some history? Tell the people about Marcus Garvey or something.
Dr. Khan said it.
Dr. Khan.
Why would I know?
In fact, the same Dr. Khan. That was what he said. And he always says things. But this one struck a chord. And then I spoke with the great Echiquam.
Yeah.
He said, oh, yes, let's do this, let's do this, let's do that. And that was it. First time we brought it out. It was magical. In fact, I used to do history, but it was more about the reggae acts.
Yeah.
Reggae artists. You talk about this reggae artist. But when we started talking the history, oh my God. I remember Echiquam at that time brought the award. I think he called it the what Excellence Award.
Award, okay.
And it was always picked up by Joy FM. Joy yeah. FM. The first time that the award went to somebody else outside Joy FM was Hits FM. And in fact, for me, it was, I remember Atu Kwame Nnadazi around that time said, what the hell is African history?
History, yeah.
We don't want to hear history. We want to hear some, you know, joking. He's always joking.
Yeah.
So yes, I mean, that is it. And I'm glad that we've been able to do that thing. A lot of people meet me and they tell me that, that history, the day you talked about this person, the day you talked about that person. And it's exciting. Even if I want to stop, I can't stop. Because it's a lot of energy.
Yeah.
Can you imagine how many histories we've talked about in the last 10 years? Every day, from Monday to Friday, five times a week, times the number of years. We don't repeat history. We go straight and then we let it happen. And it's interesting.
Very yes. interesting. How did you find yourself at Xylophone?
Xylophone. Well, I was at home after my caboodle with Hits FM. I was at home. I went to America, lectured a little bit at the University of Central Missouri, and then I moved to University of North Carolina, taught for some time, but I wasn't really accomplished. You know, so I said, well, why don't I come home? With the small money I made from the universities, I came home and trying to find myself again. Sammy Flex called me and said there was a rich man who had come around and was, you know, so rich, everybody was looking at him. What's his name? Nana Pia Mensah. I said, oh, really? He's never appeared anywhere in Ghana as a rich man. Is he a new rich man? He said, oh, yeah, it's a new rich man. He does this, he does this, he does that. I said, okay, rich man. All right, we are building a radio station. Are you interested? I said, certainly I'm interested. What would you need? Of course, at that time, I already put it out in the media that any radio station that was interested in having me must pay me a salary of 10,000 Ghana cedis. And the people who criticized this thing were the same presenters who spoke about it and said it was too big, it was too lofty, and I'm becoming so many things. So Nana Pia Mensah spoke to Sammy. I never spoke with him. And Sammy, I told him that, Charlie, I need my 10,000 Ghana cedis as salary a month, and then I need this one and this other thing. And then surprisingly, the man said, what kind of car do you want? I was shocked.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of car? And I don't know cars.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, all I said was that I need that big car that is called 4X4. You know? So, okay. All right. Any brand? I said, I don't
so
really
far as
know.
It's a 4X4?
4X4. Yeah, I'll run all. It. So he gave me a 4X4. And that's it.
Which 4X4 did he give you?
I think it's a Mitsubishi.
Okay. Pajaro. Okay.
Yes. Pajaro. Yes. Pajaro.
Okay.
That is what, you know, he gave me.
Are you still driving it?
Yes. The first time I drove a brand new car. All the other cars I drove were from Cantamanto or somewhere else. For the first time, I drove a brand new car. If I had a rubber all over it.
Rubber.
In fact, Sammy had to come and use some scissors to cut it. And it was exciting. I mean, I felt quite accomplished. And I felt that I had to come to radio, back on radio and do the magic. I was eager to return on radio. So that's how I met Nana PMS. Unfortunately, the salary 10,000 came first month, second month, and the third month, fourth month never came. For 12 months in a row, no salary came because of the men's gold issues.
Oh dear.
Yes, 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 yes. So
you mentioned men's gold. I'm wondering when the men's gold issue came. I mean, I know almost everybody who had a car and all that had their cars taken from them. People like Halifax, like Bulldog, and all those. I mean, everybody had their. How come you are still driving yours?
Oh, beautiful question. You see, I was the last person to be employed at Xylophone FM.
Okay.
So everybody was driving. Some of them had been driving for the past how many months?
Yeah.
So I was driving my old car. One day, I drove into the yard, and an appear man saw me for the first time. And he walked up to me with so much respect, in fact, and said, oh, Blakk Rasta, I know you've been driving this car. We promised that you get a car. It's been some months now. Don't worry. You cruise your car. So I said, don't worry, man. Anytime it comes. And not knowing he was doing something magic. I was in the office when a guy came and told, oh, now that PM Mensah says he wants your photograph. I didn't know what he wanted it for. And then after some time, they brought me some papers. I never bothered to look at this. Just said car papers.
Okay.
So I kept the papers. And the bulldog came and put the sticker of the station on the car.
Yeah.
So I was driving the car coolly as a station's car. I wasn't bothered anymore whether it was my personal car or the station's car.
To the station.
Until the men's gold issue started. They started taking everybody's car. So I drove to the place. Yoko
office, yeah.
I drove there and they said, ah, what's your car number? They looked to the end. I said, ah, are you sure?
Is
this from Nana PMS? I said, yes. It's from Nana PMS. Do you have the papers? I said, yes. So I gave them the papers. They looked at it. Ah, this one is in your name. It's your personal car. It has nothing to do with Nana PMS.
Oh, okay.
I said, oh, wow. So I was the only one he gave a personal car.
Car too. That's interesting.
Which I still drive.
That
to God
is
be the
interesting.
Glory.
That is very, very interesting. Wow. That's nice. So that's how come your car wasn't
In
taken
fact,
from
that's
you?
How come I still
and you've still
my car
been
here.
Driving it.
But I was honestly ready to give it out.
You mentioned that for over 12 months you haven't been paid.
Yes, yes, yes. That's right.
How come you still go to work every day? How
do you buy
your fuel? How do you feed yourself, your family? How do you survive?
The energy and the passion. Especially when you came to join Men's Gold, it was interesting. I mean, that the Abuaji that we had been seeing on TV, a man who had mentored old and younger people, was with us, very eloquent. And of course, with your activities with Chatterhouse and all that, it was inspiring.
Yeah.
You know, it was nice. We wanted to move on with the energy. Yes, let's go. But, well, it didn't also last that much. Of course, I understand what happened, you know. But Nana Piemensa told me one thing, which I would always respect. He said that this radio is for you.
Mm-hmm.
It's your baby. If you leave it, you've killed your own baby. In fact, at a point, my brother, so many radio stations approached me with more than what Nana Piemensa gave me. In fact, and I almost left. But when he told me this from Dubai, where he was gold, I listened and I said, well, what else can we do? Let us continue. Sami did so well. We had nothing. We'll go to work. Sometimes I'll be on radio and then I'll be told that, Charlie, in the next 30 minutes, the station is going off because there's no fuel.
Oh, wow.
So you have to put in all the energy. Then 30 minutes, voop. Everything gone off. Pack your things and go. Like that. No salary. No food. And to make it worse, Men's Gold customers were at our heels. I remember that day when about 30 or 40 of them came in. And then when I was called that, Charlie, these guys are here. It's not safe for you to come. I said, boy, I still have to do this show. I must do it. There are so many thousands of people out there who want to listen to this voice.
Yeah.
Let me still drive in. And when I came in, they were running after the car,
the
car. Luckily, there were some two policemen there, but they couldn't control these people. I parked in the middle of the people, and then I walked over to them. Surprisingly, when I was walking over to them, they were walking back.
Wow.
There was only one woman who was saying, yes, look at that thief. Rasta man, how can you drive this expensive car? He smoked so much weed. Look, he can't even walk well. My sister has died. My uncle has died. She was speaking in Cree. And in fact, I got so emotional. So I went over to where I was moving. There was a gentleman from Nima, from the way he was speaking outside. He said, oh, this is Blakk Rasta. Speak to him with respect. He's not one of the thieves. I was shocked. Oh, so we still have some credibility. And then I stood with the people, spoke with them, took some names. The police, the two policemen who were there were shocked that these people stood there and listened to me. These are some of the things that continue to guide me not to go overboard, not to let the people down no matter what. See? So speaking with these people, they all left. All of them left. Mm. No noise. Left the place, believing that Blakk Rasta will be able to tackle one or two things for them before I went in and did my show.
Before I go to my next question, we hit the streets to speak to some of your fans. I want you to listen to what one of them said about the legendary Blakk Rasta. You should take a listen. Just 1 second to this one. Let me just open up the volume so you can hear it loud and clear.
Blakk Rasta, I haven't heard any Western about Blakk Rasta since I've started listening to him. The good thing is he speaks to the ghetto youth. He motivates us through the black pot. So it's good. If Blakk Rasta should be in front of me right now, I will tell him to continue what he started doing for so many years. We are really behind him.
He's a cool person, okay, but when he's on the BDR shows, at times you should mind the way he talks. We like his shows and a lot, but you should mind the way.
Blakk Rasta is, for me, he's a motivator. He's a teacher, and I like the way he teaches about the history of Ghana and Africa. So for me, he's a good, and in fact, he's a leader. Yeah, that's for me. Okay, so if I see Blakk Rasta now, the only thing I would tell him is he should move on with what he's doing, because he's really motivating the youths out there.
And those are words from the streets. That's what we call it right here on Showbiz A to Z. Fans of Blakk Rasta speaking about him. Blakk, how do you feel when you hear some of your fans say some of these things about you?
It sounds to me like a dirge, to be honest with you. Mm. I feel like I've been laid in state and people are now talking about me. That's how I feel. It makes me very emotional because we've done this thing for so long. Right from the university campuses and all that, sometimes without pay. In fact, and all that. And to hear that people still have some good things to say about what we have been doing all these years. We started with so many different people. A lot of them fell by the roadside. And if we are still on and people are still out, these sound like young voices.
Yeah.
For me, it encourages me to even push on harder.
Exciting, exciting. Yeah. From the bottom. We're speaking to the man, Blakk Rasta. He's right here with us on Showbiz A to Z. Also in the studios, we have Jesse Amu Ejepon, CEO of Ifiba Consult, celebrated marketing and communications executive. Not even executive. He's gone beyond executive. Jesse, good afternoon. Welcome to the studios. How are you doing, sir?
God is good.
Kwame Rasta is also here with us. Uncle Kennedy is also here with us. Sadiq Abdullah Abu is in the studios. Blakk Rasta, did you follow what happened in Parliament recently?
Yes, I did. I did.
What's your take? Especially coming on the backdrop of a statement like this. Take a listen. What did you hear that?
Yes, I did.
Yes, so yeah. I mean, that Parliament is a very serious place, and we saw the seriousness. What's your take?
I think that we have a president who is too old to be president. That's what I think. And old age is not a matter of numbers. It's a number. Mugabe was 92 years when I went there to play for his birthday.
But he was still ruling.
He was still ruling.
He was older than our president.
That's why I said old age is not about numbers.
Okay.
Yes, it's a mentality. Mm. Many were those who thought that Mugabe would never die. Have you ever thought how come Mugabe was the most educated president in the whole world and not Africa? He was extremely brilliant. Even with that, we still told Mugabe that Mugabe, it's time for you to rest. You've done enough. You
but
see?
If he was extremely brilliant, yeah, as you put it, how come his country isn't, you know, one of the
beautiful
countries
question
the world should be looking?
Beautiful.
You know,
I don't know
that
if you have ever been to Zimbabwe.
No, not yet.
But I tell you, man, 90% of all the things that you hear from BBC and CNN, they are all cooked, fictitious stuff. I went to Zimbabwe And at a point, I remember when I was going to Zimbabwe, I spoke with Echiquam, and he said, oh, what a beautiful country, blah, blah, blah. Listen, I hardly found potholes on the streets of Harare. All the shops were well stocked with food.
But that was just Harare.
I went to Mashingo, and I went all the way to Matabeleland and some other such places.
Mm.
And it was nice. Of course, they had issues. But I tell you something.
But CNN cannot lie to us about the economy. I mean, we can just go online and know how their currency is performing.
We all know
and
that.
And it's one of the worst valued currencies on the entire continent.
Yes,
if the man was
true.
That smart, how come?
That was what I was about to talk up to bring out.
Yes.
You see, the Zimbabwean issue, if you truly want to understand it, please get the New African magazine.
Mm.
There was somebody who dedicated his time to look at Zimbabwe without the political lens. If what happened to Zimbabwe, a drop of it fell on Ghana, Ghana would be non-existent.
Mm.
Listen, Britain came in and slapped sanctions on Mugabe. For how many years now? Can Ghana survive 2 days of sanctions from these people? To the point that his money became so useless, the currency, that one day he woke up and told them, listen, we're going to spend American currency here, the currency of our enemies.
Mm-hmm.
When I went to Zimbabwe, I wasn't spending Zimbabwean currency. It was American dollars everybody was using there. And you couldn't say anything bad about Mugabe. The people saw him as a ledger. Of course, he overstayed. That is true. But you see...
Which was not so smart.
Yes. I mean, he over. And I told him right in his office, the media captured it later, the MPs and ministers were so angry with me. Why did I have to go political? I just was supposed to meet the president and say thank you and sing for him. Why did I have to talk about him staying there? Because of their selfish, egos. You see, but coming to Ghana.
Mm-hmm. And back to what happened.
Where we have a sleeping president, a president who sleeps unprovoked every 2 seconds. He falls asleep, unprovoked. We have all, you see, we have geniuses. Somebody can be 90 years and he's a genius. And he can do what a 20-year-old cannot do.
Where did you see
but
the president sleeping?
But there are a few Rasta. Geniuses.
Where did you see the president sleeping? On
oh, Lord God have mercy. I just want to believe that you are playing the devil's advocate.
No, I am not. I'm asking.
But all over the media.
I have never seen the president asleep.
Oh, really?
No, I haven't.
Oh, my God.
Uncle Ken, have you?
Everybody in the studio says,
Uncle Ken, have you?
God.
No, I haven't.
Rasta, have you? Have you,
I'm
seen the president asleep? Have you seen the president asleep? Mr. Mujapon, have you seen the president asleep at any function?
Please respect your guest.
I am. I'm just asking. Sadiq, have you?
Nobody wants to be picked up after the show.
This is a period of picking up.
I'll
urge you to restrain before you are picked up.
So Mr. President has led the country into a near banana republic. Where people are picked up at random, where some people have become teen gods, demigods. They can say anything they want to say, and until we start speaking about these things, and not being afraid of what these old people in power can do, this country is going to de-accelerate with the biggest speed you can ever find, worse than the Titanic sinking.
Slow down. Let us come back to what happened in Parliament. That was actually the
All
question.
Right. Well,
your opinion on
it's,
that.
It's the same thing about these people in power that has led to what happened in Parliament. You go to Parliament, there's supposed to be a voting. People are voting quietly. Another pot-bellied man thinks that it is the chance for him to grab some papers and run out because of indiscipline. And you check the track record of this guy who picks up these papers, and you realize that this is not the first instance of indiscipline. The same guy who broke into an interview when Ablakwa was speaking at the Parliament House and later had to come out and apologize. Number two, ran to a polling center when he knew he had tested positive for COVID-19 without a mask, without anything, shaking hands with billions of people from the graves and from above. And then at the end of the day, he was sacked by the president, even though he apologized. And then he goes again and grabs ballot papers and runs helter-skelter, left, right, and center, and apologizes again. So I keep saying, in Ghana now, if apologies became the key to handcuffs, nobody would ever have his hand in any handcuff.
But if you're talking about the one person, because there have also been news coming in from those who were parliament that he wasn't the only one who actually did interfere with the voting process. There have been other people who were also allegedly also did snatch and try to interfere and all those things. So how come you're so fixated on just one person or one aspect?
What we saw was one pot-bellied man in brown and wearing a mask who grabbed papers and was running around and people chasing him, catching him.
You did not see other people kicking ballot boxes and all those things?
Of course,
you didn't see them?
All those things happened. So what?
You didn't find those as signs of indiscipline?
It's everything there. Whoever kicked ballot boxes, whoever went there at 4 a.m. or so to sleep there because they wanted to be seen on the... I mean, it's so manual. It's so archaic, so stereotyped. I mean, in the 21st century, where digital things are flying all over the place, people leave their homes and come to the Parliament House at 4 a.m., 6 hours before. These are the same people who absent themselves when they are most needed. Yet they go there at 4 a.m. just to sit on the right hand. What is the country, I mean, getting into? It's unfortunate. I don't want my children to come and inherit this kind of chaotic parliament. Chaotic country.
Do you think it is some of the things you say on radio that made someone allegedly come to attack you recently?
Well, we have different passions. And I think that the passion that I have... Listen, I tell you something. After this attack, an embassy called me and said, do you want an asylum? We can fly you and your family out of this country. And you know what my answer was? When Obama came here, he asked me, do you want to be a citizen of America?
Yeah.
We can give you that. I said, I'll think about it. I think that my duty on earth is to be able to sit here and deal with the situation. When I was at the University of Central Missouri, up till now, the people are following me to come there and teach. I could have done that. But I think that my purpose here is not fulfilled yet. We have to be able to deal with some of these things. Let people stand up and speak.
Have you tried looking into exactly why somebody came to attack you?
Well, in fact, I expected this from when I decided to speak.
Hold on a sec. Could it be because of this?
Are you not ashamed to be part of this country at this point? Let's go straight to the point. Let's call a spade a spade. Now you have just finished your Kakamoto B elections. And some people believe that the election is credible enough for us to hold on to a certain winner and a certain loser or a certain group of losers. Are you crazy, Ghanaians? Are you crazy? Or you are refusing to think? What is happening in this country, my brother, my sister? Forget about the dreams Blakk Rasta had. Forget about prophecies people had. If you're all EC that has never been funded like it has been funded in these times can come out not once, not twice to tell you time and again that there were discrepancies and the figures have become nothing but chameleon figures changing colors every now and then. Worse, my brother, my sister, than the Efiakuma traffic light in Takrade. And you still have the guts, my brother, my sister, to hold on to a certain result and say that it is credible enough for you to celebrate a certain winner and then divide whatever to some group of losers. You must be crazy, Ghanaians.
Could it be?
Well, it could be this and more. I think that we have said more punchy things than this.
Mm.
Yes, I mean, right from Hits FM, when I was coming to multimedia, they say, hey, the nonsense that you were saying at Happy FM, you can't say that at multimedia. But multimedia even loved it more. You know? Yes, I mean, the Nagombes have a saying that you look at the stranger, the kind of stranger, and decide what kind of meal to serve that stranger.
Mm-hmm.
And Alaji cannot come to your house and you know he's so rich. And then you serve him with two zafi with no fish. You see, every stranger comes in with a certain kind of reception. That's how it is. You see, so for me, anywhere I go, people see the passion.
Yeah.
People see the energy. And people see that, no, this is not an idiot. This is not an ignoramus. He's somebody who knows at least what he's talking about.
Yeah.
And the good thing is that nobody can align me with any political party. People who have followed us for some time would know that, yes, oh, which president came here and we haven't spoken about him? Somebody says, why are you not talking about this president? Why should I talk about people in opposition?
Mm-hmm.
The president is the one who is using my taxpayers' money. The president is the one we've given the mandate to make us comfortable.
Let us go into the occurrences or the happenings of that day. You were on air.
Yes.
And what happened?
Yes, I was on air. And you know the security is there is very tight.
Yeah.
Because of the men's gold issue and all that. Well, I was on radio. I'll tell you from my perspective. On radio, doing my thing, I had just finished with the Black Pot. And I was switching to the African history class. And all of a sudden, I realized that, the machines went off. But it was dicey because the air conditioner was still on.
Mm.
And I was waiting for the producer to come in. And I mean, Sadiq here will tell you that I'm a very passionate person when I'm on the radio.
Yeah.
I don't see people. I don't hear people.
Yeah.
I'm just there doing my thing. Until it's over, then you see the jovial Blakk Rasta.
Yeah.
You see, we have had to's and fro's now and then. And that went on to make the show better. So the producer wasn't coming in and I was just about to explode. Then he popped in and said, 1 minute. And he came in and said, oh, somebody came here with his face covered and he was shouting, where is that Blakk Rasta? Where is that Blakk Rasta? And the security was asking him to stop. He wasn't stopping. And they are chasing him around, but he's gone upstairs. Please hide under the table. I said, is it that serious? I should hide under the table. No, I'm not hiding under no table. what are you going to turn me into? Then you come and video me, Blakk Rasta is hiding under the table. Put it on Facebook and all those places and laugh at me or what? So I was still trying to come to terms with what this guy was saying, but he was panting. Then one of the security men came in and said, please, can you go to your office? And I realized that, well, it was a little bit more serious than what I thought. So I walked into my office. Then I heard a gunshot.
Wow.
I thought it was a warning shot from the police because I was told that the police had been called. After 5 minutes, nobody came to update me. So I came out and then they were carrying this assailant away. Some huge guy carrying him away. He said, was he shot by the police? No, the security man here shot him because he tried to jump from the top there. He went into the server room and then he started destroying machines, pulled the wires. That was why the station went off.
Is the security man still at post?
He was at post.
How did the man get past him?
Interesting. So I was telling you from my perspective.
Okay.
Now from his perspective, the brother came in there and said he was from the national security.
Mm.
Do you have an appointment with Blakk Rasta? He said, yes. So, okay, come in. He came in. Formality, sign here. The moment they gave him the pen, he started heading towards the studio. Running, not walking. Where is that Blakk Rasta? And security man started shouting at him.
So wait, let me understand.
Mm-hmm.
The guy came to the security man
yes.
with his face covered.
No.
Or he covered
came
his
there,
face.
His face was not covered at the gate.
Okay.
You see, and even if it was covered, this is COVID-19.
Well, yes, of course. So maybe that's the mask.
So he came in and then they allowed him at the gate to finish with the formalities. Then they would lead him to the studio. But he started running. And then he found his, according to the technician, he perpetrated him. And
he
ran away. When he ran away, he now destroyed the studio upstairs. Our transmission went
who
off.
Sprayed who?
The assailant who came had a pepper spray. The technician. Yeah. So he jumped from the first floor.
Wow.
Down. Ripped to the ground.
The assailant. Wow.
From the window. He wanted to escape through.
That's about 20 to 25 feet.
Yes. Jumped from the top then. I'm still wondering how he was able to break his leg. He came down and was trying to jump over the wall. But you know the place has barbed wires all over the place. So he couldn't. And then he tried to hide. One of the guys saw him. Said, oh, wow, wow, wow. He started wrestling. And he almost finished the guy because this is a giant. Wrestled the guy. And then when the security man realized that, hey, if we don't save this guy, he will finish him. He brought out his gun, pump action. Trying to fire his leg, according to him, and from the statement he wrote, then the guy all of a sudden turned. So he shot him in the back.
Mm.
There were only two pellets that fell there. The The rest entered the guy's back.
Is he still alive?
Well, police hasn't updated us, but what we are hearing in the news is that he has escaped. That's what we are hearing.
The injured man has escaped. Yes.
Took him to the hospital.
Police arrested him, took him to the police hospital, mm-hmm. handed him over to the doctor, and left him there. And now we are hearing that the guy has escaped. We are waiting for the police to come out and tell us that, oh, Charlie, this is what is up. We haven't heard anything yet.
Are you afraid? I mean, do you feel scared after something like that? Have you gone to the police to give you some kind of protection? What have you done to protect your own life?
Well, what I've done is to take personal security, because I was expecting that the police would have said, listen, your life is in danger, because we reported it to the police. We were at the police station for over 1 hour. Mm. The police did not deem it fit to say, oh, let's dispatch one man to take care of you. So I just decided to do it on my own. As for being afraid, I don't remember the last time I became frightened at anything. No. I mean, these are some of the hazards of the job. It's not everything you will say that people are going to like. No. So I expect that once in a while, we'll see things like that. What I did not expect was a man coming in, breaking security protocols, and heading towards me with whatever weapon he had to try and finish me up. But that still is an encouragement. It tells me that, hey, people are listening to you. It tells me that, hey, what you are saying makes sense. What you are saying, get more sense into it if you truly want to change the system. It's an encouragement to me.
We are having a conversation with the man Blakk Rasta. We are right here on Joy 99.7 FM. It's Showbiz A to Z. Check with your time. It's 32 gone after 4. Show is proudly brought to you by Ghana's most reliable mobile telecommunications network. That's MTN. We dare for you everywhere you go. It's also brought to you by High Five Choco Malt. That's the new normal. Let me bring my panel into the conversation right about this time. It's getting pretty interesting. Jesse, you are the one closest to Blakk Rasta, so I'll start with you. Have you followed the man? Have you been following his show on Xylophone?
Yes. I think I followed the personality for like a while.
Yeah.
I probably may not be an ardent listener of his program.
Yeah.
But at least every Ghanaian might understand what his packaging looks like.
Yeah.
So to that extent, yes, I'd say yes.
Okay. That's Jesse Ajapon. You know Jesse? Blakk Rasta.
Why would he? I'm not.
Oh, Jesse is a big man. Jesse used to be the marketing director for Tigo.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so that's all those big concerts. The very first time Tigo actually did a big concert, it was this man that made it happen.
I should have known him long since.
Yeah.
He's a C-suit marketing coach.
Exactly. That's the man.
Did you have a question for me?
No, I didn't. I'll just your thoughts on what Blakk Rasta has said so far, actually. Yeah. You know, on some of the things. I don't know if there's any particular subject matter you'd want to pick on.
No, I can speak to what happened at the station.
Yeah.
Except that I have a view on the characterization of parliament as mm-hmm. it is today.
Yeah.
And if there's time, I might speak about it.
Oh, no, you we'll definitely get there, because we need to pick our opinions on everything that happened. So, because, yeah, so you can, sure. you can go
so
ahead.
So my,
yeah.
my view is this, that I try not to pick one thing to overgeneralize a situation.
Mm-hmm.
And so I might pick Blakk Rasta today, and somebody might say, because he says something bad, it means that in its entirety, he's a bad personality. I don't think that's a proper characterization of things. I also didn't hear him say that per se about parliament. But I've heard people say that if this is the kind of parliament we have, then we have leaders who are misguided. We've used crazy words to describe them. But again, this is the same parliament that said that I could go to basic school for free.
Exactly.
It's the same parliament that said that my son could go to secondary school for free.
Yeah.
It's the same parliament that said that we should expand water across the country. It's the same parliament that said that telecommunications should be spread across the country. Terrific. It's the same parliament that is investing and supporting almost every executive decision. So parliament has its positives.
One key one. For the same, for those of us in this particular industry, the fourth estate, as we call it, it is the same parliament that has granted us the right to information.
Exactly. Yet again, it's the same parliament that may have issues where sometimes some of the decisions that they might take might not be. However, what is parliament? Parliament is chosen from amongst us. So we are in parliament. Parliament is Rastafarians, Christians, Muslims, gay, lesbians. Whether it's in secret or it's in the open. Parliament is people who drink. Parliament is temperamental people. Parliament is also quiet people.
People who like to sit on other people.
Exactly. But I'm just saying that, George, Parliament is everybody. So when something happens in Parliament, and what happened in Parliament didn't include everybody, there are those who might be the bullish part of every society. And it's permissible sometimes. And when I was in the University of Ghana, you would say, what's the role of Commonwealth Hall? Commonwealth is not just about radicalism.
Yeah.
They were sharp-minded individuals who added the balls to the demonstrations and the drives that we had to go through.
Yeah.
So long as our community is a composition of every part of who we are,
we should find them in Parliament.
Don't be shocked that people fight in Parliament.
Yeah.
And don't be shocked people insult in Parliament. Don't be shocked that the Kojo upon Kromes in Parliament. Don't be shocked that there will be the Sadiqs in Parliament. So let's not be too shocked, and for me, overbox Parliament.
You can't be shocked that Kennedy Ejepong was quiet.
Yes, so I'm just saying that, George. I'm just saying that. I'm just saying that Parliament is just us.
Yeah.
So there are some things when I see the parliamentarians do, I don't get shocked because that's who we are. So when the fight was happening, there were those who were quiet, sitting like Blakk Rasta here today. Yeah. Because that's who they are. And there are those who also help with the aggression. That's who they are.
Like Blakk Rasta. Yeah,
exactly.
Like Kwame Rasta.
Like Kwame. Okay, so which is fine. So I think the parliament is a mixture of what is good and bad about us. We have a right to criticize them when we feel they are going AWOL. But I don't think I would overcharacterize them as a bunch of buffoons because of one night's activity.
Yeah.
That I will not do. And that's my view.
Nice one. Nice view. Rasta. Blakk Rasta. I know, I mean, your fellow Rasta man is here, so you feel at home, eh?
I mean, we've always felt at home in each other's company.
Exactly, I know,
Serious, intimate moments up on the hills, you know, so, I mean, it's always family. In fact, when he was invited to appear before the Privileges Committee of Parliament, I happened to be the only dreadlock wearing human being sitting right behind him in that room. Our brothers were barred from entering the parliament space because they were Rastas. Deep me and him, how I managed to get that's another story. But taking a cue of feeding off your energy where you ended up, like, you know, in other words, you're saying that we shouldn't expect so much of our same people who are representing us, because they represented every shade of color that makes us whole.
They are who we are.
Yeah. Now, I have been fortunate enough to have taken a position on parliament a long time ago. In that, I do not in this era of being picked up for, you know, or being sought after like the way he was looked for, I would have to be careful with my choice of words, but I've never really expected so much from Parliament, like a very long time ago, because primarily the processes that it takes one to be elected, most of the parliamentarians, the politicking, they go and look for your name in a register, then you, a whole honorable or candidate, aspiring candidate would lead fellow citizens to go and fight or double in some ungentlemanly act. That is even at the constituency level. The kind of things that happened before, or you'd have to turn a blind eye to, or tacitly endorse, or directly endorse, before you get the nod, before you go and listen. If you at that point are still expectant that these people will get to the final destination and act like they suddenly have found some wisdom or sense, then you didn't get the memo at the very first instance.
Yes, but so, Kwame, on this point, right? If you say one is equal to all, then I would agree with you, because in I ascribe to those who say that it might be wrong to overgeneralize. Because there's one bad nut in it, or there's one bad activity in it. But if the principle is that one is equal to many, or one is equal to all, then when one messes up, the whole is affected. Then I agree with you. Okay. Because the path to getting there for over 275 of them is very different. And so my issue is about the overgeneralization of what the body looks like.
You see,
that's my issue.
It's the same coin, and you've chosen to look at it from the, you know, the other side of it. But it still happens to be the same body. And for me, looking at it from that other side, which is what I've chosen to, because for a dreadlocked wearing young man in Ghana, the kind of prejudices and the abuse that I suffer, my kind suffer. And I am a direct sufferer. I mean, I was citing the situation where he was invited before the Privileges Committee, for instance. Human beings were... It's a public place that we had a right to show support or for. And my ilk were bad just because of a part of their body. Okay. Nice. So, and this is where the nation's wisdom and knowledge is supposed to be housed. So when at that place, it's also assumed, or you can say by extension, that the police officers there should be at the top, or the security there should be at the topmost, or, you know, so everything there is top-notch. So when security try to deny us our rights just because of our body part, then, and even before that, when I'm driving with you in your car, I am frisked
more.
And then you are left alone. I mean, there's so much. We are not talking about dreadlocks and it's, you know, how we suffer. But I'm saying that I have a position against the house because of their own doings, which informs my rights as a human being. So if I am saying what I am saying, it is because I know these people and how they see me.
All right. Okay. Point well made. Uncle Ken.
Yep.
Blakk Rasta is in the house.
I've known... Blakk Rasta for a while, and we've been cool, me and him. We don't have any issues, and I was a bit upset when he left Multimedia, but, you know, that's life. People come and go, you know. As to what happened at Xylophone recently, George Quaye.
Yes, Uncle.
Me and you were not there.
No, we weren't.
So I cannot challenge anything from the submission he's made so far.
No, except... But Fifia Manzuba is saying that, look, he knows Xylophone too, and there are cameras all over the place. Mm-hmm. So at least somebody should have captured the person's face and all that, and their media organization. If the guy has run away, put out his image and let everybody look for him some. Uh-huh. Yeah.
I'm a bit surprised that he was able to get through security to do all what is being claimed he did. That surprises me.
Yeah.
You know, then so I ask myself, what sort of security did they have at Xylophone?
Yeah.
Especially when the guy was asked if he had an appointment with Blakk Rasta, as he himself said
just now.
And he said yes. And then, according to him, immediately he was granted access. He started running. Didn't that raise any eyebrows to the security person or whatever? The whole thing is bizarre, as far as I'm concerned. But like I said, me and you were not there. So I cannot challenge anything that he said so far. And if it is true that the assailant has escaped, then, you know, this brings me to my problem. In this country, we never bring closure to any issue. Issues come up, we raise them, blah, blah, blah. We talk so much, and then the issues disappear by themselves without any closure to the issues. You know, George, something that really upset me about Parliament was when a parliamentarian, who was it? Is he a Rastafarian? Ras Mubarak.
Ras Mubarak, okay.
Yes. You remember the allegation, the 2,000 or 2 million allegation against Shatta Wale?
Yeah.
Where did this happen? This happened in Parliament. at the Public Accounts Committee of Parliament. No other place than the Public Accounts Committee of Parliament. The gentleman got up and made an allegation against Shatta Wale. I expected the Public Accounts Committee of Parliament to have delved into this matter, to come out and tell us whether the allegation he made was true or false. What happened? We've all forgotten about it. Shatta went ahead to do a few, what do you call it? I saw him in a few... Advertising the so-called
Well, he did what he had been paid
he
to do.
He did what he had to do. Or what
he had been paid to do.
Or
contracted
for.
To do. Yeah.
And so do we know for a fact whether what the gentleman raised in Parliament was factual or false? We don't. And we are never going to know. You know, these things really upset.
Uncle Ken, now that the information...
Whose responsibility is that?
Somebody's got to prove.
At the Public Accounts Committee level...
Right.
Yeah.
Let's pretend the Public Accounts is reviewing an audited state statement.
Mm-hmm.
And in the audited statement, I need to ask questions. Why is George Quaye paid $30,000 and Nash Okor was paid $2,000? So I have a right to ask. It's just a... Is the question?
You do. People say that's why Nash Okor left, because Nash Okor realized that they were paying George Quaye $30,000. Charlie, I owe people. No,
don't be making these examples.
George, what Bosje is saying is not what actually happened in Parliament.
No. I'm just saying that at that auditing level,
right?
I can raise query based on observation. Now, I felt
this
that...
This guy raised the public interest question.
Yes. No, I get that. But Uncle Ken.
Okay.
Uncle Ken, back to...
Let Jesse finish so we can get back to Blakk Rasta.
Back to the fiber of what Parliament is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Parliament is the guy sitting at the beer bar asking a question, the guy in the bank asking a question. Mm-hmm. It's all of us. It's the interest. So when somebody... I'm going to ask a public interest question. A public interest question is simply a public interest question.
Right.
And it would be that, did we pay him $2 million? If we did, for what job done? My hope was that the Exim Bank would have come out to say that this and this are the fine details. Then those who were interested in the public question would say, okay, so that's it. Because it wasn't Parliament's job to then compel them to come and answer per se. They called them to come and answer. They asked the guys to come and answer. So
to be fair to us,
yes,
and the then minority,
yes,
they pushed and demanded for the Exim Bank to appear and answer questions, but then majority kicked against it, and this is a matter of
I didn't know that. I'm just saying that.
He'll confirm.
Gentlemen, let's go. This is getting interesting. Looks like this. Uncle Ken, you mentioned Shatta Wale. Sadiq, you haven't spoken. Let's hear Sadiq first.
Talk for me. Shatta Wale matter.
No. I have a Shatta Wale question for Blakk Rasta. Yeah, that's why. Yeah.
For me, this issue of trying to stifle freedoms to commentary and speech is becoming one too many.
Has it got anything to do with Blakk Rasta?
Yes, I mean, speaking about the attack, for instance.
But how do you know
allegation.
It had anything to do with stifling his speech? Because maybe it was somebody whose girlfriend he has collected.
Well, it's likely, but in this particular case, it's happened one too many. Blakk Rasta is not the only media person per se who had been attacked, trolled, or anything for that matter, in respect of their public commentary. So I'm speaking about a trend here. You know, speaking about the trend about where political fanatics and overzealous politicians who are in power, for instance, in fact, threaten that they are going to do these things, and then next minute they do it. I mean, I've had the chance of addressing some things like this within the week, also related to the Bulldog arrest, for instance. It's becoming one too many. And this is one of the reasons I was speaking about it, that when you guys that are in power begin to do these things, people begin to take a cue. Some of your followers or fanatics will take a cue and begin to want to do these things.
That's the more reason why. Sadiq, hold on. In all fairness, there is no proof yet that
George,
Blakk Rasta's issue has any political connection.
Okay, George, do you have proof that Manasseh's threats?
No, but we're speaking about Blakk Rasta.
I'm speaking about a situation that it's a trend.
You
that
see,
media people,
no, when you do that,
George,
Blakk Rasta himself, do you feel it was a political instigation?
It could be anything.
Blakk Rasta, wait. So, George,
yes.
George, I
but
blame you.
Did ask him
when you were going to ask him the question,
yeah,
you played a voice.
You play the voice you played.
Why did you play that voice? Davis,
no, you played a voice that said
of what he had said.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And in the course of this,
the foundation for the question seemed to have been grounded on a political connotation.
Okay, if you insist.
So we blame you.
Let's blame. Philip gave me the voice to play.
And most importantly for me, Jesse, most importantly for me, I'm speaking about a trend here.
Yeah.
A trend that had been pointed out by the Medium Foundation for West Africa, for instance, a trend that has become a very topical matter where when people speak their mind, some of these political funders, and I have screenshots of some of them saying, they'll deal with this guy. And in fact, in the next minute, they deal with the person in the ways that they do. Mm. We need to begin to talk down on some of these things. It's becoming one too many. This is not proper. This is not what we want. Of course, we all don't want people to engage in undesired commentary, for instance, or commentary that would, abuse the rights of others. But most importantly, some of these things should stop. It's becoming one too many. And for me, it's actually even becoming nauseating that some of these political fanatics and followers and all of those things will engage in some of these things. This is wrong. And particularly when they use state, organizations to perpetuate some of these things. It's not proper.
Point well made.
Yes.
What's your relationship with Shatta Wale like?
Oh, Shatta Wale, we used to have a very beautiful relationship in the past, you know, but now I will say the relationship is ice cold. Yes, even though not malicious.
Ice cold.
We haven't said hi, how are you doing, to each other for more than 10 years now.
Interesting.
Yes.
I wonder why. Hold that thought. I'm coming right back.
You see, I was not ready to play his music. But after about a year or so, you know the Blakk Rasta that Rasta is?
Yes, man.
When the music is good, we play.
Yes.
Once in a while, I would drop one or two of his songs that I knew, especially that Mama song. Because the rest of the time, his songs were dancehall playing. Yes. And I don't like dancehall.
Yes, man.
Would you fight me because I don't like dancehall?
Nah, man.
We all have our taste. Even some of my biggest critics and my biggest fans tell me that there are some songs that I make that they hate so much they don't like. For instance, Malam Tonga. Mm. There are some people who say Blakk Rasta.
We will come to Malam Tonga. We will come to that.
Things like that. Mm. I don't like dancehall. Everybody knows that Blakk Rasta is a roots man. Give me the one drop. Chunk, chunk, boom. Chunk, chunk, boom. And that is what uplifts me. I believe that to be able to uplift my listeners, I have to uplift myself first. Charity begins at home. Mm. And they had a problem with that. The moon Blakk Rasta is fighting dancehall and blah, blah. They try to get a few boys around them to try and fight me in one way or the other. But I'm too strong for anybody to fight them.
Yes, man. Hard
for that. Yeah, because I don't walk alone. I walk with the Spirit of God. Mm. How can you bring me down? Mm. Do you know where I'm coming from? Do you know what kind of energies follow me? You are just joking. It never work.
But quite recently,
for real,
when Shatta was, had a feature on Beyoncé's Foreign.
Yes.
Yeah. Ready. He came out to say that he was actually acknowledging you, that you inspired him to be a king. Would you still call him ungrateful?
You know the history. No, you see, this ungrateful thing I'm talking about was then.
All right.
He has never come back to apologize and say that well. And I'm not even looking for that apology.
Sure.
For me, I have grown spiritually better. And I don't keep grudges in me
Oh mama, I lie me tell her, if me say me never miss you. No matter how much hunger, make the cold them move. No matter how many times I walk without no shoe. Mama, you remain my darling mom.
2021 is your year, so don't just insure your car, insure Nefili. Insure your car with Enterprise for an amazing surprise. Get free fuel. Yes, free fuel coupons, free sanitizers, and a lot more. Look, 2021 is your year. Please insure your car with Enterprise Insurance and win big. Dream big with us. Enterprise Insurance, that's your advantage. Terms and conditions definitely do apply. And don't miss out on another great way to save this new year with Game Stores. Unbeatable 40 Ghana cities deals. Get to Camp Master 5kg briquettes for only 40 Ghana cedis, or 2-4 special 750ml red wines for only 40 cedis. Deals valid from January 1st to January 31st. Oh, sorry, to March 31st. Oh, that's 3 solid months. View deals at gamestores.com.gh or visit your nearest store. Terms and conditions also do apply. And if you're listening to us and you're driving, please avoid all distractions. Keep both eyes on the road and hands on the steering wheel. Please be visible. Drive with your lights on in foggy or hazy weather, or even in the evening. That's how you ensure your safe arrival. Arrive Alive campaign is brought to you by Toyota Ghana Company Limited, Toyota superior quality, and Total Petroleum Ghana PLC committed to better energy. And I did indicate earlier that on Sundays the footballers meet at the park, or Omoto guys at their joint. Church folks share the grace and friends and family come over to visit. But now with MTN Sunday special, your Sundays just got a lot more exciting. For only 54 pesos, you can text and talk all day, every Sunday. And if you push that up to 169 pesos, you can talk the whole day and get a cool 20 megabytes of data. Now here's where it gets even more exciting. For 217 pesos, you can call all other network all day, plus free 50 megabytes of data. So who is it you love talking to? Is it your mom, dad, sis, bro, or that special somebody? Just keep talking all day every Sunday with MTN Sunday Special. Send yes to MTN short code 5050 to sign up on MTN. And that's why we're good together. Day for you everywhere you go. We're gonna go next into a second convo, and Blakk Rasta is gonna be a part of that conversation as well. It's very important. But let's go and have this convo on my man Shatawale. You were saying earlier that it is not so rosy anymore. Why do you think it's because of this?
Well, you granted? I think that we had some differences in the past. I mean, we were okay. I mean, from what you played, you realize that it was all about airplay.
It was, yeah.
You know, there was a competition in the days.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the Dancehall King competition.
Yeah.
Which Stoneboy was adjudged the winner.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, he wasn't happy. And I was in Nigeria. When I arrived, I called Stoneboy. He told me his part. I called Fifi Sela and the rest. So when I called him, he was mad.
Oh, dear.
He said, "Who is this?" I said, "Oh, this is Blakk Rasta. Why are you calling me? Why are you calling me? I don't respect you. Don't call me again. I don't rate you. You are calling to laugh at me." Yes, Stoneboy just went there to mime. And me, I went there to sing. And you are laughing. You want to laugh at me. Get out. Get out, my father. I don't respect you. I was shocked because we had never degenerated into that. All I knew he wasn't happy about was that he brought me 4 songs. And I was playing 1 song. There was a mama song that he brought, and I'm glad to say that I was the only one in the whole Ghana that had it. Because he was an underground artist.
Mm-hmm.
After he came out with Bandana from Ghana, Moko.
Yeah.
And he came up to me, and I played that song because I could relate to that, song. And he was angry that he brought 4 songs, and I was playing 1 song. But he never told me. Until he appeared on Lagazi's show. He had a TV show at that time. I think it was called Dub Legend. And then he was angry. I gave Blakk Rasta a lot of songs, and he's playing only 1. He's a hater. He's blah, blah. I said, really? It was after that I called him about this Stoneboy thing, and he got mad. So I told myself that, listen, if this guy can be disrespectful, I think that we can also be disrespectful. Of course, these were thoughts of yesteryear, several years back. I mean, so I decided that, I will not even deal with him
deal
at all.
With him at
I
all,
won't
yeah.
play your song for you to say that you gave me 100 songs and I'm playing 1. No. So I left him like that.
You know.
And then after some time, I wasn't hearing from him. He wasn't hearing from me. Then, final thing, there was Ramadan time. In fact, I was fasting and so hungry. I was driving around Aveno there. Just here. I left the studio and got to Aveno. And you know that normally there's traffic there.
A lot.
I realized that there was a car, some Corolla or so, coming from the back, breaking all the traffic rules. Beep, 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 coming. And I was looking at this car from my mirror. So, where is this guy going? Is there a sick person in it? Not knowing the car was coming for me.
Oh, wow.
It came straight and blocked my car. And he was in this car with a guy I got to know later as Arabi. And he started, "You're a thief. You're a thief. Look at my album, the cover. You stole the cover. Look, you used it for your album too. The cover design. You stole it. You are a thief." And I was sitting in the car shocked. Then he was being handled by Mr. Logic. So I called Mr. Logic and said, "This is what your boy just did." He said, "Well, don't worry about it. You can ask Mr. Logic. But, well, these things, I see them as youthful exuberance, you know. So I just let him go. I was mad. I was angry because I had no idea whatsoever what he was talking about. I let him go. I'm happy for him. He's been, in fact, I never gave him a chance because all the songs he brought to me, for me, they were noise. I don't like dancehall. The dancehall I know is raga.
Yeah.
Coca-Cola, Buckley Shepard, Gelly, Randa, please. Shaba Ranks, Kote Ranks, Nado Ranks, and all those people. That's my generation.
You just tickled Jesse's fancy.
You see,
he likes Tingalingaling.
Tingalingaling. That's my era.
Yeah.
And the jungle era.
Yeah.
Puyaka.
Puyaka, puyaka. Incredible.
Incredible.
That kind of thing.
mad,
try to get into their groove, it makes me feel like I'm faking it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I can listen to Uncle Ken play all the oldies and I get an erection. Very strong erection. And I'm like, what is this? Sometimes I come over to the studio and look at him and say,
"Wow, playlist.
This is crazy." Because these were the songs my father played.
Blakk Rasta, I'm happy about what you just said. At least what I play at night doesn't do that. We thank God. Now we know those who caused the problem here at Sports Media.
Don't run away.
We know.
Don't bring yourself.
Blakk Rasta, thank you very much. Blakk Rasta, we're gonna bring our conversation to a close. But I Shatawale is your brother.
Oh no, I mean, no. We are for me.
Yeah.
In fact, for some years now. Oh, you listen to my show.
Yeah.
His new song, One Done.
I play it.
Sometimes I just drop them, not because I like them,
mm-hmm.
but just because I cannot pretend that I don't.
You don't.
I'm not a fan of Shatawale's music.
Okay.
I am a fan of the guy.
Let's get into it. Our next is who leads the Tourism, Arts and Culture Ministry in Nanado's second term. But I've got very quick fire. This one, very quick. Don't think. Just answer very quickly. Are you proud of the music industry that we have today?
No.
Okay. What puts you off about the industry? What do you hate
the most?
There's
no creativity. It's all noise.
Okay. What do you make of... you've answered that one already. So let's go on. What's your relationship with Bulldog like?
Oh, good relationship. He almost got a collaboration for me and Shatawale recently when I did Malam Tonga.
Mm-hmm.
I realized that you only have my songs that are 10 years old. Please, okay. I have some newer albums, hotter
yes,
albums.
Yes, please bring them so that we can also play them. Very good, very good. Did you also invest in Men's Gold?
Unfortunately, no.
How come?
Because I was the last person to be employed, just like you. You didn't have the opportunity to invest. There was no opportunity.
Why are you boys laughing?
This is a contrived question.
Are you married?
Yes, I am married.
How many children?
I have 4 children.
Okay, that's nice. You are Muslim.
Well, I'm not religious. I've said it time and again.
Because you
religious.
Mentioned a few minutes ago that Ramadan, and if you were observing Ramadan,
you
must be Muslim.
That, you will see me in church. I go to church. I go to the mosque. When Ramadan comes, I fast. Sometimes I even do extended fasting to 40 days.
So where do you stand?
In fact, I do not want to be controlled by religion.
Mm.
Because for me, religion is ideas of men brought together to control human beings. That's what I think.
So you're
you
not religious?
With, no, no, no.
So why do you fast?
I mean,
what
when
for?
When Christ came, he
why do you
down
fast?
All these things.
So why do you fast? What for?
Oh, that's spirituality. I am spiritual and not religious. Religiousness is a certain kind of... Let me get a softer word, because this one might sound like the philosopher who said, it's the opium of the people.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
For me, I don't want to be in that programmed style.
Okay.
For instance, as a Muslim, if you are going to pray, you have to wash your hands.
Yeah.
Wash your mouth. And you can't wash your nose before your hand.
Sadiqise.
Mm-hmm. Your hands You wash first. Your hands first before you go to your mouth, before you go to your nose. If you make a mistake and wash your hands, if you're supposed to wash it three times, if you make a mistake and wash it twice, your ablution is vitiated. You see, for me, it's more of a programming.
Okay.
I want to be able to walk to God, even if I'm sitting on my WC. I should be able to say, hey, Father, I'm here. If I'm bathing, I should say, hey, I'm here. That's the kind of...
But do you worship anything? Do you worship anyone or anything at all? Do you pray God. To God?
Yes, I walk to God when I'm naked.
Which God?
Which God?
Yeah.
How? Are there different gods? There's only one God of the creation, the one who created you and me. I don't see... Then that means we have gods. Nobody has ever told me this.
Charles Darwin says we weren't created. We evolved from monkeys and stuff like that.
No, I believe in just one God, the God of Moses, the God of Muhammad, the God of Isaac, the God of Jesus Christ.
I am confused, but I hear you.
Gentlemen, did you used to be a Muslim, Rasta?
Did I used to be a Muslim?
When you growing up?
I used to be everything.
A little bit of it all.
Yes.
Let's get into it. Oh, we're running out of time. Yes, this show is probably brought to you by MTN. Of course, we're there for you everywhere you go. Also from High Five Choco Malt, the new normal. So, Mr. Jesse Amwejepong, I'm going to start with you on this one. Blakk Rasta has been speaking for long. We should start with, okay, Sadiq, let me start with you since you are closest to me. Who leads the tourism, culture, and creative arts ministry in Nanado's second term? And, you know, I mean, why would you choose whoever it is you choose? We want to do this very quickly so we can open the phone line so Blakk Rasta's fans can also interact with him and also share their thoughts on who they think should lead our ministry. A lot of names have come up. I mean, names like Catherine Afeku, Marco Kreku Mante, Obua Juliet Asante, Dr. Muhammad Awal, Barbara Otin, JC, Kwesi Ajiman, and a few others. Who, in your opinion, should lead the ministry?
For me, for the substantive
I actually wish
minister.
Today I was asking the questions.
Say again?
I wish today I was asking
the you questions. You were the one asking the questions, eh?
For the substantive minister, I think that Muhammad Awal or Kwesi Ajiman for the substantive will be a good choice. And for the deputies, I mean, I've gone on record to support Mark.
I thought you supported him for substantive.
It will be difficult to get the substantive.
No, but you did.
For deputy. So I've always supported Mark to be deputy, consistent with the call made by Jesse during the campaign time. Because obviously for the MPP as well, they don't have... they are not going to have a creative arts minister. If that was the case, then Mark would have been a very perfect substantive. But in as far as they put it together to have a Ministry of Tourism, Culture, Creative Arts, I think that we've all agreed some time back that if that's going to be the way it goes, then once there's a substantive that overlooks the ministry, there should be somebody also in charge of, say, creative arts. And I think that Mark will be a very good deputy to either Muhammad Awal or what's his name, Kwesi Ajiman. That would be a very good.
So for you, it's Dr. Muhammad Awal
or Kwesi Ajiman for substantive.
Okay.
And then Marco Kroko Mante.
So for you, either Dr. Muhammad Awal or Kwesi Ajiman, then either of them should work with Marco Kroko Mante.
Exactly.
As Uncle Ken.
Yes.
Your thoughts.
I like Sadiq.
Sadiq kept it simple and straightforward.
I told you the last time we were here and raised this issue. That was before the new year.
Yeah.
Or even before the Christmas celebrations.
Yeah.
Remember this thing came up and I said to you, I do not blame and I do not envy the president
at all.
One little bit with what's going to happen the second term, especially with his appointments. I have been one person who has always been against the fact that the president has been given too much powers to nominate almost every single person who's going to be working in the public service and ministries and all those things. I think it's too much and should be looked at. But when it comes to this ministry, I have been sitting back listening to people mention names and advocating for this. And what I realize is that everybody is being, I wouldn't use the word selfish, I would rather say everybody's going along with who they think will be best for where they fit in.
Okay. Okay. So you mean people are looking out for their personal interests?
Yeah, they're looking out for their interests. Mm. Yes. Thank you, George. They're looking out for their interests. And it makes me smile most of the time when these things come up. Because I say, then what about the other? Because don't forget, this is a ministry divided into having three separate entities. So if you in the arts sector are looking at people who you think are your people to be pushed there, what about the others?
Mm-hmm. What about culture?
Yes. What about culture? What about an artist, for instance?
What about a painter? Painter. You mean a painter, yeah.
You know, and it that's why I say I do not envy the president.
It's a tough job.
I also think that what is the purpose? You see, I think it's because of our system whereby political parties vie for power, and then the political parties who vie for power and win power have to satisfy their followers by giving them appointments. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise, I say to myself, look at that ministry. Haven't there been people who have been in it for a length of time and have gained experience within the ministry who could do a better job if given the appointments?
And the technical people there.
Yes. I ask myself, I say, what have they gained?
Yeah.
And what are they using that experience, all the experience,
for?
Over the years.
Yeah.
If we would not give them the chance to be the people to lead.
Yeah.
Because of the political party system, George.
So let us assume these were the only names available to us. Who would you have gone for?
I don't know. I will leave it to the president.
Okay. Interesting. Let me move on to Kwame Rasta. And just as you're thinking about it, for those that do not know, Dr. Ibrahim Muhammad Awal was the minister, you know, technically, they are all unemployed at the moment.
George, please.
Yes.
Just one.
Yes, Uncle Ken. Go ahead.
The reason I said I don't know.
Yeah.
Is because of precedents.
Okay.
There was a time there was a sports journalist.
Do you agree?
Oh, a Sadiq Grady. Let me speak my mind. Are you my lawyer?
We are back.
Made sense every week with his articles.
Okay.
Okay. And therefore got appointed to a deputy ministerial position. And what happened?
But was it Joe Agri?
I leave it there.
Was it Joe Agri?
I'm not mentioning names. Ask Sadiq. He knows. He's in my head.
But Joe Agri and Joe Bidu and Sawe, journalists are
going. As I was saying, Dr. Ibrahim Muhammad Awal was the Minister for Business Development. He was former Managing Director of Graphic Communications Group Limited and also Chase Petroleum. He is an entrepreneur and a marketer, was chief executive officer of Marble Group, which comprised the Finder Group of Newspapers, HMW Printers, Marble Consultants, and Marble Developers. He was adjudged the Market Man of the Year 2009, I think, by the CIMG, and holds a doctorate in business administration and three master's degrees in various disciplines from different universities. The man day four, Kakra, he's pretty solid. And then, of course, we all know Juliet Asante. Juliet is the Executive Secretary of the National Film Authority of Ghana, Board Chair of the National Film and Television Institute, NAFTI, and founding President of the Blakk Rasta International Film Institute, organizers of the Blakk Rasta International Film Festival, BSIFF. She chairs the Curriculum Committee of the Creative Arts School, a revolutionary educational concept by the Ministry of Education, and is the founder of the Asantewaa Library Project Building, and stocking container and block libraries in Ghanaian communities. I mean, she's a management consultant, change agent, and strategic thinker with experiences that span two continents for over two decades. She started help to build and managed organizations and products globally. From 2008, Juliet served on the World Economic Forum's Global Entertainment Council for 2 years, playing key role in the council's strategic direction. And then that brings us to our own Kwesi Ajiman, who's CEO of Ghana, was CEO of Ghana Tourism Authority. And the CEO of Ghana Tourism Authority, lead public service agency in charge of regulating tourism in Ghana through marketing and promotion, licensing and classification of tourism facilities and services, investment, research and development. Prior to his appointment in January 2017, he was shareholding partner of Global Media Alliance, which is a marketing consultancy and broadcasting company. That is YFM ETV, and they have a number of billboards around town and stuff like that. And then as the managing director of its broadcasting operations, he was in charge of one of the TV stations and four radio stations. Until recently, he was the president of the Ghana Independent Broadcasters Association, holds an MBA in marketing and information systems from Tulane University in Louisiana. He got that, I think, in 2003, and an MBA merit scholarship recipient as well. He also holds a bachelor's degree in social sciences, 1993, and a master's in public administration, MPA, 96, from the University of Ghana. He's got over 15 years of experience working in the space. Rasta, I'll give the rest of the profiles as we go along. Now, your take.
If this is the list.
Mm-hmm.
Or the potential candidates to assume
that
position.
Yeah.
I but for the substantive slot,
mm-hmm.
which I wish that Akwesi Ajimai would avail himself to assume that post, because he is proven. You see, George, you read a few of the biographies or extracts of biographies from a couple of these.
They are CVs.
Yeah, they are CVs.
And you see, people can have academic excellencies, mm-hmm. you know, and that's where their excellency, you know, hits its height, and it ends there.
Asa?
When it comes to actualizing what they have learned on the grounds to inform our situation, in this case our plight, then it turns into something else. You could, I was reading the former minister,
Barbara.
Yeah, I've never been a fan of her.
Oh, I love Barbara.
Good for you.
I won't lie to you.
You see, and the simple reason is...
I love her personality. I love the way she goes about her stuff. Okay. There's some...
But you don't love her work. You can't stop.
I love her work too. What has she done? There is... I'm coming. Look, maybe because I'm a communicator, I approach things differently. It may not be the best approach for a lot of people, but I think when people know how to communicate and they don't talk too much... Being a communicator who's got the gift of the gap, I mean, people like me, we have a very serious shortcoming. We end up talking too much most of the times. But Barbara never spoke too much. When I look at Barbara and I look at Catherine, the one thing that I did not really like much about Catherine was that I thought she spoke too much. And you see, when you speak too much and you're a politician, sometimes you end up over-promising and under-delivering. And that is what I loved about Barbara. Barbara didn't, she won't speak plenty. She won't even say much. You understand? The debate as to whether she got things done or didn't get done, of course, she wasn't the only one working. There were people like Ojo Inchi, people like Marco Kriokumante, people like, and all those things. Yes, I'm host.
You should put your thoughts on your Facebook wall. But, I haven't met, and I don't need to meet the minister in charge of creative arts.
Yeah. Yeah. If I were hosting a radio program, I'll play the tune.
I swear.
Charlie,
don't worry. Your suspension, we're warming it.
I know.
You know, you came back recently. You can keep quiet. Let's go on, my brother. Yeah.
I was saying that right from her vetting.
Yeah.
When she sat in front of camera and told me that she was going to, when she comes, one of the revolutionary initiatives that she was going to introduce was to set up a gold museum in her constituency at the place that she came from. I've forgotten the name. For she to have told the world...
Pristia Honey Valley.
I beg you. Listen, that was like, yo, Afeku did what she had to do, paid the price. She had to be relocated. And I do not know what Madam Barbara did with her expertise and not being the chatty-chatty type like the way you have contributed. To be relocated from the forestry division, the forestry ministry, to the Creative Arts Ministry. Mm. I don't know what she did so well to earn her being substantive minister of the Creative Arts. But listen, how many morning shows under forestry do we have in Ghana? Don't answer. I am saying that we have the creative arts space is completely different in terms of we have a number of morning shows of serious radio stations pitched or themed on creative arts alone. Mm. That's how serious or how directly involved like citizens are with creative arts matters. You wouldn't, of course, see.
So, the long and short, you don't think she's the right fit for the space.
You see, it's not like I'm picking on her.
No. But you've made the point.
There's a reason. There's a science behind why she is still being considered or in our list.
No, Rasta, I think we should leave what other people are saying. Who do you think should lead the space?
That's the question. I mentioned that Akwesi Ajumah would be, for substantive, but for the deputy ministerial, role. Now, I don't see anything. Like, it's purely ceremonial. If some big man die for a funeral, then if you be the deputy minister, where you don't have anything to do, then you pass through. If listen, if you're an MC, if you're an MC, for instance, under this government or under any government, you are even more valuable because you cater for a sect of people, for health, for construction roads, forestry, agric, creative arts within that municipal area. But when you are the deputy minister for creative arts, unless some buffet for some place, jollof party, then they need government to represent. Ghana Music Awards launch.
Are you done?
They need, listen.
You've made your point. People, so you don't think there's a need for a deputy minister?
Oh, I think there's every need. Of course, it's okay, Kumanke. But those.
So it's okay. So that's it.
Angling for Obuo, my own, I went to Jaso to work for him to be MP. Yeah. It didn't work out. I have seen Obuo. He's too qualified for that. Any deputy minister, creative as deputy ministerial. So I think that he should be angling for an MCE or DCE in Jaso.
Okay.
So that I can help his MP ambition directly dealing with the constituents.
All right. So we also had some, before I come to Jesse and Blakk Rasta, and I know, I can see the faces. I know they are boiling up their thoughts. Blakk Rasta. We spoke to some industry personnel, who have also given their thoughts on this. And we've got one very big man on the phone lines who's also about to give us his thought, who he thinks should lead the industry. Before we go to the phone lines, let's hear Trigmatic.
Well, Master, who leads the Tourism and Culture Creative Arts Ministry for the second term, I do not know. But with the names that I've seen, it's not about the names for me. For me, and this is what we've done in the past that has always given results. For me, it's who has the ability, the capacity, the know-how to run the office. It doesn't matter. So I really don't have a pick. May the best person get the position. And of course, some of us will be there to make sure that they are accountable for their deeds. And as usual, this time I think Ghanaians are going to the new phase where it's no longer about talk, it's no longer about personality, but people demand accountability. So for me, anybody that will sit in that office would be moved to do what they have to do, because the work must be done. It's not about personalities any longer. I've seen the names on there. Mr. Awao, who was at the Business Development Ministry, did an incredible job. All of them have good track record, but what it is we and a few have their flaws, and a few have. So for me, it's not about who's my favorite or whoever will be put there. Whether you are a favorite or you're not a favorite, you will be forced to do the work. I think this is what Ghanaians will have to look at. The need for true accountability is what we're looking at.
It's Showbiz A to Z.
And that's my man Trigmatic giving his thoughts there. We're going to the phone lines, and we've got host of Good Evening Ghana from Metro TV, Mr. Paul Adum Ochre. Paul!
Hello.
Good evening. How are you doing, sir?
Good evening to all your guests.
Yes,
good. I'm enjoying the program. I usually listen on Saturdays.
Well, thank you very much, boss. Good to know you've been tuning in, just as we do with Good Evening Ghana. I hear you have an opinion to share on this one regarding who leads the Tourism, Arts and Culture Ministry.
Yes, I have a matter to urge on your panelists and all of us. I think we should begin to look at tourism differently, if we can, from the way we've seen it. I think tourism should be looked at within the context of marketing and finance. It's really a marketing thing. And once we look at it that way, it's not an event. It's a philosophy that must permeate everything that we do as a country. The finance bit is to indicate how much money comes in and how much money is required to bring how much money in through which event. And every major event that we do in Ghana must be conceptualized within the context of tourism. So if the president is going to give a sessional address to parliament, the major national event that we can also sell outside in terms of how our country looks, it's a matter for tourism. What happened on 7th January for an African country to have a speaker of parliament from a different party and a president from a different party, all coming through a process of election, is a matter for tourism. Tourism must look at it and see how Ghana can be sold using this event. If the Black Stars are walking out of the field to play a friendly game against Nigeria, it's a matter for tourism. Tourism must be used through that process to make Ghana great and to sell Ghana out there. And the finances, what mechanisms are we going to use to tell the world that as an African country that is able to achieve what you see in the established democracies? People celebrate America for having a different party in Congress and a different party in the president. And they say that, oh, in America, these things are possible. As for American politics, is great. It has happened in Ghana. It's a matter for tourism.
I think you're right. The point is pretty solid. That is true. You know, and that is what brings in the question as to who leads us. Who's got this kind of mentality? Paul, do you think you should be the next minister?
No, certainly not me. So once we identify tourism as a marketing and finance thing, then we look for people who have experience in that area and who have demonstrated that they are able to achieve this thing. So you have to go to people who have worked in marketing companies, your MTNs. I mean, MTN is a marketing company. Every day they are a marketing company. Every hour they are a marketing company. That's why I think George Anda, unfortunately he lost his seat in parliament, but I've always thought that a person like George Anda would be very useful for tourism. Of course, when he came into government, they put him in Ministry of Communication because of his MTN background. But his MTN background as marketing director of MTN, I think suits him better for the modern way of doing tourism, what South Africans do. So if you ask me to put up a name, I'll talk about the marketing people, your George Anders, your Joel Nettis, your Nokodias, your Gedilais. If you want me to come more modern, your Jesse Gapos in the studio. The people who have been able to do marketing. Tourism is marketing and finance. And if you do MTN and telcos at the top level, you are dealing with marketing and finance. If you do television, like Talal Fatal has done, you are doing marketing and finance. Talal Fatal put up MTN Sports Academy. Those are the kinds of skill set that you will be looking for to fix the person as a minister of tourism. Because if the president is going to do the budget, you want to ask him that. President is going to do the session address, sorry. What do we do with tourism? He'll tell you, let's get an advert on CNN very quickly. That's tourism. And I'm really hoping that people will see it that way. I hope that I'm right and people will see it that way. Well, and let's begin to get billions of dollars from tourism because we can.
Thank you very much, big boss. I mean, Jesse Ajaponsa, he didn't hear it well, so you should mention his name again.
Well, the Honorable Jesse Ajaponsa.
Oh, thank you very much, Paul. Thank you very much. Keep listening. If we need any further clarity on anything, we'll raise you on the line again. Thank you very much, sir. And that was Paul Adom Oche right there. And gentlemen, you know what's interesting? Another person who's been listening to the show is George Anda.
Yeah, George Anda is on the spot.
Whose name was part of the list that included Honorable Jesse Ajaponsa.
Yeah.
And George Anda had sent me a message a few minutes ago that said, enjoy your program, keep it up. I think Akwesi Ajaman will do a great job if you ask me. That's pretty interesting. Very interesting. All right, Jesse, it was your turn. Blakk Rasta is going to have the last bite on this one because I know he has a lot to say.
So there are some moments that you need to savor a little.
So let me, please remind me again what you called me. Honorable Jesse.
Honorable Jesse. It just
sounds even better. So my approach might be a little similar to Paul's approach.
Yeah.
And before today, we had always discussed who leads the ministry. We'd been very biased towards somebody being strictly a creative arts person. But now that we are in the cabinet room now, the conversation needs to be broadened a little bit, like Uncle Ken said.
Yeah.
So the ministry is really about tourism. It's about creative art and it's about our culture.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, we're moving into an era where financing...
Oh, Jesse, hold on. I'm just getting a message from somebody very close telling me that the presidency is listening. So let's continue.
You shouldn't have said
that. I need to. So now, honorable just said Japan, continue. Yeah.
So the my thinking is that now that we've gotten to the end of it itself, we need to be able to broaden our scope a little bit widely. Now, who should sit in that particular seat? Number one, the person should be an individual who understands the promotion of tourism.
We
all admit that even though the Year of Return was great, George, the Year of Return is just one of the things that may pass like Emancipation Day. And if you remember, we've seen major activities happen on the tourism front, and many that we haven't harnessed consistently over a long period of time. So Year of Return is come and gone. We probably need to wait another 100 years to drive such an agenda again. So the question is this, that how do we drive the promotion of tourism as a country? And I think Paul had made a point again. The second thing for me is the value of tourism itself. It's easier for anybody to say why he wants to go to Dubai, George.
Yeah.
It's easy for somebody to say why I want to be in Brussels or why I want to be in Paris.
Yeah.
And I feel that Ghana's position in terms of building our value for tourism has not been well shaped. And for me, that's one of the most disappointing things for me. So I've had reasons to ask questions of what is Brand Ghana doing? So you pick an institution like the Secretariat. What is Brand Ghana doing? And where does Brand Ghana sit? So if Brand Ghana sits at the Flagstaff House, who's running it and what's happening to it? If Brand Ghana sits at a GIPC, who's running it? What's happening to it? Because that's all part of packaging Ghana. And I heard Paul say packaging Ghana and driving the Ghana agenda.
Yeah.
So the first question is this: defining Ghana's tourism potential. And I feel we've been overly overly hiding under the ad hoc gains from the Year of Return.
Mm-hmm.
It's done. What's next?
Exactly.
5 years before the Year of Return, what was Ghana's there? Tourism drive? Yeah. It was nothing. 5 years after that, what would it be? Is it about our history? Is it about our culture? And again, so I feel that the entire conversation about Akwesi Ajiman is great. He did a fantastic job.
Yeah.
The question is, what next? The third thing that drives my attention for the ministry is the creative arts side. Now, in truth, the creative arts has existed broadly without any specific policy framework or direction. So, and there are lots of businesses within the creative arts space. So whoever fits the ministry today needs to understand two key things. First one, how do I put energy within a sector that has existed without any policy-free framework? Now, if you don't know how to harness that potential, don't waste your time in the ministry. Mm-hmm. It's a waste of time. Because the event organizers, the media agencies, the promoters have existed without you.
Yep.
So all they are looking for is somebody who knows how to harness them and make them do better. The second part, the fourth part, is that beyond harnessing the existing ecosystem itself, is bringing the Creative Arts Agency, the ACT, to life. For me, within the next 2 years, whoever sits in that particular seat needs to understand the operationalization of what has been passed by Parliament. Now, so in view of that, let's talk about the names here.
Yeah.
And for me, I feel that to be is better than to seem to be.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, I don't care about your CV. What I care about is what we've seen you do so far. So I'll first limit myself to the names here.
Yeah.
When I mention Catherine Afeku, what comes to mind? She's an Nzema. She comes from the same place I come from. And I wrote three key things: affable, hardworking, driven, sacked.
Yeah.
Now, whether you like it or not, if you're sacked from a ministry and you need to be returned to the ministry, Charlie, it's a hurdle.
The reason must be unquestionable.
Yes, you see,
it must be solid.
See, yeah. When if the president will spend time,
yeah,
speaking to each one of us, to Ghanaians, and saying, I'm appointing Blakk Rasta because of ABC. Yeah. What would he say? He needs to say, oh, I sacked her because of this. And I feel that it's not true, and if I'm bringing her back. It's too long. I didn't think that her name would feature here.
Yeah.
Even though she's probably great for who she is. The second person is Marco Kriku. You're talking about the ministry.
Yeah.
When you talk about Mark, it's not about the CV. So again, Mark's last posture to Ghana is music.
Yeah.
It's VGMA. And Max seems to be like a music historian. So he's got like a institutional memory of how our music sector has evolved so far. And Max has played a key role in identifying who's doing great within the music space. So Max has been largely music driven, shaping talent and building music talent. And advocacy.
So managed one of the biggest record labels, Slip, and all those things.
Obo.
Yeah.
If I think of Obo, what comes to mind immediately? Music.
Yeah.
comes to mind immediately. Musica comes to mind immediately. And there are those who believe that the biggest reforms in the music sector came under Oboh.
Yeah.
Now, when I was coming here, somebody said, okay, maybe Oboh, there was an issue with the creative arts and the money and things like that. But somebody also said to me that, look, that money was given to him because of Musica, mm-hmm. not necessarily because of the entire creative arts itself.
Yeah.
So there's a misconception out there that he took money for creative arts people and only piped the money to the Musica side. So and I feel that maybe his PR didn't work effectively at that time. So you think about what we bought today, I'm thinking of music, reforms, musician, and again, somebody who has an imagery to clear whether it is right or wrong.
Or wrong, yeah.
The next one is Mohammed Awal. So Mohammed Awal's picture is here, his name is here.
Yeah.
When I think of Mohammed Awal, what comes to mind immediately? Daily Graphic. And the reforms he brought in Daily Graphic, leading him to winning the marketing practitioner of the year. The CIMG personality of the year or so.
Yeah. Marketing man of the year, CIMG, yeah.
Then Mohammed Awal went to Ministry of Business Development. Now pause on that thought and ask yourself, has the startup ecosystem changed drastically because of him? If I take a look at the ease of doing business in Ghana today, have we seen our indices change as a country because of that? Do we have a startup act?
What did he put in place?
What's in there? So if I take a look at the entire ecosystem for startups, because his job was to ensure that startups are doing great.
Exactly.
And we are developing more businesses today.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the single biggest drive that may have happened under Awal at the Ministry of Business Development? Because don't forget, I already said that the businesses within the Creative Arts ecosystem are already existing.
Mm-hmm.
So if Awal gets the job today, his job is to say, Uncle Ken is a fantastic music person. How do I get him to do more?
Yeah.
Blakk Rasta is a great movie producer. How do I get him to do more?
Yeah.
If he couldn't do a lot of that with the Ministry of Business Development, then I don't believe he might be able to do that here. If he did a lot of great work with a startup ecosystem, then I would believe that he can harness the creative potential better. Exactly. So again, we need to question that. Barbara, I can't tell, and I disagree with you.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that, look, the creative arts sector, it's one that requires, George, rigor, engagement, communication. It's about creativity. And these are people who must be spoken to all the time. And George, to be fair, it's like having a finance minister who never speaks. Because if you have a finance minister who speaks, his statements can change stock exchange prices. Yes, you know, it changes things. So you can't have somebody leading the tourism and creative arts sector and tell me that, oh, maybe she doesn't like to talk. Then you have no business being there. Because you need to be able to influence conversation and change. The last person is Akwesi Ajimai. George, Akwesi is like it's a friend of the media.
Yeah.
Akwesi is like a clear advertising person. Akwesi is a marketing person. Akwesi probably today benefits from the biggest platform that probably added so much value to the president today, which is Year of Return.
Mm-hmm.
So my question with Akwesi is a Year of Return enough to get in that particular job, especially when maybe 2 years before the Year of Return, we didn't know exactly what we're doing. And 2 years after the Year of Return, the question is, what next? The next question for me, George, if I put all of these people aside, is which of these people here are parliamentarians?
Yeah.
But the president also needs to know. I mean, he already knows.
He knows.
That he needs to choose
a certain quantity of people from parliament. Yeah.
So all the people here are not from parliament. Oboh is not in parliament. Mark is not in parliament. Catherine is not in parliament. Our lady here is not in parliament. So the question is this, that there's a Herculean task. Now, if you ask me who should go to that ministry, as you've been asking so far, my belief is this. One, I'm looking for somebody who has a business acumen.
Yeah.
And somebody who has an extremely passionate drive. I still insist that it's the only ministry that I would be happy with the president if he had one minister and two deputies.
Yeah.
If it's possible.
Yeah.
And in view of that, I don't mind these three people. Now, again, Oboh can come back into the ministry, can come into the ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And hindsight, I was against.
Yeah.
I was against he.
Because I was going to come there, just about 2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago, I said that.
Yeah.
I was against he being there.
Yeah.
But I also feel that if he needs to be there and he can bring value to it,
mm-hmm.
he should be able to fight his demons
mm-hmm.
and do what he has to do.
Yeah.
That's one. Again, I'm not being gender biased, so it's fine. George, you want me to mention your name?
You were saying?
I could. So, I think that Oboh should be on the plate.
Yeah.
The second person who should be on the plate is Mark.
Yeah.
The only problem is that both of them are music inclined. Mm-hmm. And so both of them, for me, are fit for purpose. Mm-hmm. And both of them have demonstrated understanding of that part of the ecosystem. The second person who's demonstrated a stronger acumen is what you might have, say, Akwesi Ajiman.
Yeah.
So from a...
Just go ahead.
So from a business perspective, I've seen Akwesi Ajiman do a lot on the business side.
Yeah.
And therefore, I feel that he might be in a good position to drive what you might call the business part of things. Mm-hmm. Then there are those who are not on this list who have been mentioned. And I would say my own brother, Kujo Ponkroman. Mm-hmm. I think he's a fantastic person. And if he was part of the plate, it would be super, super great. Mm-hmm. He's been at the Information Ministry. I'm not sure where he's going next.
You see, the problem with Kujo is that...
Yeah, I beg you.
If
you
Kujo leaves Information Ministry right now, who is coming?
No, let me... I'm like,
the marking scheme high. Who? Me, George Quaye? Oh. Information Ministry. Mention so, it. Says properly. Just please proceed.
I feel that he could do a fantastic job there.
Yeah.
And then I know George's name has been mentioned.
Yeah.
Now, for many people who know George, George is bullish. Mm-hmm. He's tough talking.
Yeah.
He's nice. He can be annoying. But he's one of those people that if you say, challenge boss, break this door for me, he'll break the door for you.
That was what I was coming to. Exactly. Results oriented.
Exactly. So
yeah.
I'm just saying that it would work. So if I can put all of these people there and say that if any of them is leading the ministry, I would be super happy. But I would hope that we have a ministry that has one minister and two deputies. And to be honest, for the presidency's sake, understanding the tongues working and so I need I'm recommending a deputy in charge of the creative arts sector.
Mm-hmm.
And a deputy in charge of tourism and culture.
And culture, yeah.
And then
yeah.
I have a minister.
I agree.
Who's Excel sheet oriented?
Yeah.
Who knows how to check the global funds moving around for tourism?
Nice.
Who knows how to go to Dubai and go and make a deal and come back? Who won't sit at home?
Yeah.
Nice. I said it the last time. The president launched the NEIP. Said he's seeding it with $10 million.
Yeah.
They should raise it to $100 million.
Yeah.
And do business with it.
Yeah.
It was driven by my good friend John Kuma. He did a very good job. That department came under Mohammed Awal.
Yeah.
My first question to Mohammed Awal will be, how much more did we get
from
so far as that fund is concerned? Because the creative arts sector must also be funded. Mm-hmm. So tell me how you funded the Ministry of Business Development, and give me the confidence that says that if you have the creative arts fund, you know how to go to Abu Dhabi to help the investors come through. So again, look, I'm not a minister of state. I probably might never be. But so these are my initial thoughts on that. If anything fails, George.
Initial.
These are my thoughts, man.
Then,
all right. Former for just.
It's Showbiz A to Z, right here on Joy. We're gonna go to Blakk Rasta, but before we get to Blakk Rasta, let us listen to George Britton on who he thinks should lead our sector.
I'll select Dr. Mohammed Awal to lead the Tourism, Culture and Creative Arts Ministry under Nana Akufo-Addo's second term. Dr. Awal was the Minister for Business Development under Nana Akufo-Addo's first term, and I think he did marvelously well. Well, he might not be popular, but he's very, very decent gentleman who can lead us, you know. Honestly, we prefer him to lead, and of course, Mr. Okrekumante to be his assistant, just to drive our industry to a safe haven.
And here is the man who's been trending all week, Obi Nate.
Dr. Mohammed Awal, I think he tops the list because of his experience and his works over the years, proving that he has the capacity to handle the ministry very well with his marketing entrepreneurial skills. I'm hoping that he'll be able to use this expertise to raise the standard of the creative and tourism industry and also make it better than before.
All right, so we're on the show, Showbiz A to Z, right here on Joy 99.7. The argument, the debate in the studio is crazy. So if you hear a lot of noise in the background, forgive us. Blakk Rasta, your thoughts?
Well, the interesting thing is that I have a certain kind of relationship with all of them.
All of them. Mm-hmm.
Presently and also in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Catherine Afeku, I met her before, twice. We had something that she was supposed to do with us at Xylophone to promote tourism.
Yeah.
Interviews on radio.
Yeah, I remember. So Christopher was very instrumental in that as well.
Yeah, very nice person.
I'm surprised so Christopher's name hasn't come up from any of you.
George.
Yes! So great.
Moral support for the incoming...
Blakk Rasta, continue.
Yeah,
please.
I mean, I worked with Mark for 1 year at Hits.
Hits FM, yeah.
Yes, and then... Hits, 1 year. Yeah. We worked together here at... You know, and then Obuo too, I was one of his ambassadors for some time at Musica.
Yeah.
So I know him quite well. And then Awal is my brother. I mean, I met him several times. We speak Dagbani, we laugh and do so many different things. Akwesi Ajima, I worked with him for 3 solid years
yeah.
at Happy FM.
Happy FM, yeah.
They're all very, very nice people. Now, you see that the tourism industry, the arts and culture, that's a very solid something.
Yeah.
Some countries have only that, and they are making it. Look at Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago, and so many other such countries. Tourism is their main thing.
Dubai.
And they are okay, Dubai. They don't have to drill so much oil. They don't have to break the ground, pollute the waters, and get some gold.
Yeah.
You see? But my problem is this. When the fish is beginning to rot, it starts from the head. Another thing is that, you see, all these wonderful people, no matter how good your football players are, if the coach is lousy, you will see it from the way they play with that cohesion. I don't trust Nanado. He's not a man that I trust.
Mm.
You see, I gave him my trust right from the start. Oh, Africa without aid, Pan-Africa, anything Pan-Africanism, you find Blakk Rasta there.
Sharp.
They failed with a year of return. If you're an historian, you will know why they failed. The first time people were asked to return to Africa, in fact, people from this country, today called Ghana, they started it. People like Chief Charles, people like Adokwe Kofi. And you need to read history and get to know this. Long before Marcus Garvey, how did they fail? The people who instituted the year of return, did they historically go into it, or did they think that it was an off-the-hook kind of idea that they grabbed? No. It wasn't. I was hurt that they had this brilliant idea that was going to happen, and I was all over the place shouting that Ghana was making it. Jamaicans called, Americans called, they all wanted to come here because as a Rasta man, they see it as repatriation as ordered by the Honorable Mosiah Marcus Garvey. But how did they mess it up? Commercialization. We are looking for people who can come and do business here. The poor ones are not necessarily invited. You see, you killed it. People are here to connect with the spirit of Africa. Don't ask them how much they have in their pockets before you grant them visas.
Mm.
So for me, we have a lousy president, and no matter how good all these players are, it's not going to work. I'm not going to bet on any one of these. We have a president who sleeps on the job, my brethren. These are the things I say that some people get a little, I don't know what
but,
it is.
But Blakk Rasta, the thing is this.
Yes.
Whether the president sleeps as you opine, or jumps, or walks, or somersault, there would still be somebody who would lead the sector under
for
which
real,
you and I find ourselves. And that is why I think, let us leave that aspect.
Okay.
You understand? We have appointed a president. Whether we like it, whether he sleeps or snores or jumps or whatever, he's still our president for the next
out.
4 years.
The way
you
know, out.
In 4 years' time, you can use your thumb
no,
to make
no,
a difference.
No. The way
but for
out
now,
now. You're talking about now, right?
No, for now, let us focus on who's going to lead our sector.
That.
Uh-huh. That's so what I want to hear.
People,
yeah.
What I'm saying is that.
Yeah.
As long as we have a lousy president, they are not going to make it. In order to make it happen, the lousiness must change into efficiency. We are not ruling out the president or any other person saying that, hey, you are a good for nothing person. It's not going to happen. No. There's always a way out. Bob Marley said, is there a way for a hopeless sinner? Certainly there's a way.
Blakk Rasta, may I ask you a question?
Please do.
So I've heard you use the word a lot of times,
yeah,
lousy.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel that for those listening to us, we need to probably contextualize it, right?
Okay.
So let's say the president is lousy because he failed in the health sector.
Mm-hmm.
Or he's lousy because we failed in the educational sector.
Mm-hmm.
Or he's lousy because our territorial integrity has not been defended even better.
Mm-hmm.
Or he's failed because within the agric sector, there's famine in Ghana and we are doing terrible.
Okay.
So that at least we can situate it. Because you see, otherwise, right, then it looks like a motherhood state statement which has no basis.
Okay. Well,
so why? Okay.
Your question is why?
Why, yes.
Well, if I have to go into this,
oh, just
George,
a little.
You may have to give me some 2 more hours.
No. You can summarize.
So,
just a summary. Yeah.
Just a summary.
Yeah.
Listen, I am so disappointed with Ejaba. I am totally killed by Noll and Associates.
Mm.
I died several times with this fuel issues and all that. Now, another thing is that this country has almost become lawless, especially at this time. We have people sitting on radio and TV threatening to kill former president. Our president is going to be a former president soon. You understand? And if you will sit down and watch those people with no action, then I want, you see, opinion out if you're Oma, everyone say blah, 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 blah. Yeah, kind. Okay. That's all I'm saying. Look, we are looking for the betterment of this country. Nobody is throwing around worse. I am so, look, when, listen, all these wonderful things at the beginning were so nice and so beautiful.
Wonderful much things
as
like
you
what?
Clap for, I was talking about the fact that the president said he was a Pan-Africanist. We had return to Ghana, return to Africa, return home. It was a brilliant idea, beautiful thing. We were so tired with, you know, some of those people, and we wanted new faces. This was our champion. Then all of a sudden, we're seeing borrowing, exponential rates, and all that. We are seeing, you know, you don't want to talk about the president, but he is the head. As long as the head continues to be there.
Yeah, sure,
you
can come in.
It is
anyway,
going to continue.
We're running out of time. Jesse, you have something to say quickly on this one, so we wrap it up.
So
yeah.
There are some things that he may be unhappy with,
yeah,
the president.
Yeah, 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 that's what I noticed.
Which,
yeah.
which is fair.
Which is fair. I mean, so, everybody can have
that. But I still want to hope that maybe he can. So, Blakk.
Yeah, yeah. So, with all these people, yeah, they are brilliant people. Some of them I'll rule out totally, like Mark.
Yeah.
I rule him out totally. Because this is a guy I don't trust.
Okay. Next
because
person.
Because I worked with him and I know what he can do.
Next person.
And I know, yeah, you don't want me to go into detail.
No. It's the time. We have five more minutes to wrap up.
He's a nice person. Yeah. But I cannot be sure about how he handles money.
Okay.
You see, Awal is another wonderful gentleman. He's my brother.
Yeah.
But I didn't see so much activity in his
when it was
office,
a business
for
development.
That matter,
yeah.
Sorry. Mm-hmm. Akwesi Ajimai, for me, is too slow for my liking.
Mm.
Too slow. Okay. We want active people. In these times, slow people should take the backbench.
Okay. Catherine?
Catherine, well, wonderful person, but I think and feel that she, for want of a better word, let me slow it down. She lacks a total understanding of the industry.
Mm-hmm.
From my interaction
from
with
your interaction with
a
her.
Few questions.
How about Barbara?
You know,
Barbara?
George Ander, looking at how he started with MTN and all that. For me, I thought that MTN was an autopilot. He didn't really contribute anything that much there. He's going to be unhappy hearing this because I have a relationship with him too. But the truth is the truth. I don't think that he will do well there. Now, who else? Barbara, these were the people who brought the year of return, right?
Yeah. The year was in motion before she took
before
over.
Barbara.
Yeah.
She promised the gold museum at Nzema.
Oh.
And it didn't happen.
Well.
She forgot.
To God be the glory. Juliet Asante, yes. She's been with us in the media. Pretty lady. You know, running around with that. We have been really seeing her track record. In terms of something.
So Blakk Rasta, there's no money there.
Who would you suggest?
Okay, should we give it to Kennedy?
If you ask me,
mm-hmm.
I would say you should try some newer hands like you.
Who?
Like you.
Who?
Yes, like George Quaye, a.k.a. Abuaji. You could try people like that.
Blakk
you don't
Rasta.
Have to be a politician before you occupy something.
Blakk Rasta, if you want to say
would
that.
Would you do it yourself?
Uncle Ken.
For me, myself? Mm. Under this government?
Not under this government.
Uncle Ken. Uncle Ken.
For the state of Ghana.
Uncle Ken.
For me, I think that I was brought here to do other things rather than occupying offices and all
other
that.
Things like what?
Good. I think that I'm a kingmaker. I will be able to tell you that, well, I think you should consider this person. Consider that person, because rather than being a king, I think...
Blakk Rasta, hold on. Uncle Ken, don't interrupt. The presidency is listening. You said they should try who?
George. Honorable George Quaye.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. It's been an exciting show. We are going. Yes, final thoughts. Uncle Ken, I'll get to you. Since Blakk Rasta just spoke, let me go to Jesse, then we'll come round. We'll wrap it up in a minute. No, we're just coming back, then we wrap up. Okay, Jesse, quickly, so we can go.
So, I think that the next 4 years should see a lot more value within the creative arts space.
Yeah.
I think this is the opportunity that those of you in the industry have to drive real change.
Yeah.
And if you ever get a job here, please spend less time being a pundit at radio stations.
Exactly.
Go to the office and do the job. The finance minister is not a daily pundit anywhere. So you should also sit in your office and do your job.
And do your job. Rasta, few seconds.
the evidence is clear that we have the men
to do the work. BP, okay.
To get the job done.
Yeah.
And, listen, somebody like Sucre Safo.
Yeah.
All jokes aside, I think that if he's granted one of the agencies, he's a hands
on person kind of man. Yeah.
He should be considered.
Okay.
Fred Chemens as well.
Yeah. Uncle Ken.
Yeah. I am very disappointed at some of the utterances of Blakk Rasta. Disappointed in the sense that people like Blakk Rasta, who see nothing good in anybody, because out of the lot, Blakk Rasta saw nothing good in anybody. And that is why I'm asking him that if you see nothing good in people,
then who?
You, the person who sees nothing good in anybody, can you do the job if given the role? Unless you tell me, yes, I can do the job, then I don't see any reason why you should condemn other people.
Okay.
Sadiq,
let me come.
Yes. I think that. We're out of time. We're out of time. Yeah. We're out of time. Sadiq, quickly.
For me, I think that the guys that I mentioned are very good, but Blakk Rasta says something that's very instructive.
Yeah.
Which is the fact that if the government generally do not really prioritize a sector, anybody they put out there will not do anything. Mm-hmm. So most importantly, particularly where in the last 4 years, for instance, there's been a lot of lip service to the sector. It's a real concern that regardless of who was
which
there,
we've spoken about, which
priority.
We've spoken about over and again.
Yeah, there needs to be a
and
certain
I'm
priority
sure
from the
all
top
these
that.
People are aware of all those conversations already. Mm. So let us, for now, at least
we need
add
to
our voices.
To on it, most importantly.
But Sadiq, you
it's
see,
a, it's a matter what, of it's a
let
real
me tell
concern.
You, let me tell you why I think this exercise has been very important. We are fortunate to have the presidency listening, and the sources that it's coming from, trust me, they wouldn't be telling us lies. And these conversations inform the decision.
So this is where
everything
we need to remind them that
hold on.
Since the last 4 years
hold
was disappointing,
no. Sadiq,
the next 4 years should be
Sadiq,
encouraging.
You see, we will fail to let them know who to choose, and then they'll choose somebody and we'll come and sit here and criticize. So let us use the opportunity that we've been granted to let them know who to choose. Once the person is put there, then these other conversations can come to that. My guy, you got this job now. 4 years, blah, 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 blah. We're expecting better. I think that
it's fair, but it's not bad to also mention it now.
Yeah. That's sure. Yeah?
He's going to court. So he doesn't have to. I don't even know why he's offering an opinion.
Showbiz A2Z was proudly brought to you by MTN. We dare for you everywhere you go. Also, special thanks to High Five Chocomo, the new normal. Blakk Rasta, thank you very much for passing through. We hope to see more often of you. You know.
That would have made me say 1 second, at least for a second.
Please go ahead.
I mentioned you.
Yes.
If you say I don't see anything good about anybody because of these 6 people here.
Oh, well, you have a point. Yeah, it's unfair.
A terrible remark from a man that I admire.
Yeah, it's unfair. No, don't mind. I can't hear like that, too.
No, you didn't see anything.
Only these people.
Yes, and then thank you very much, Mr. Jaziam Wejepon, Kwame Rasta, Uncle Kennedy, and of course, Sadiq Abdullah Abu. The news is coming up right after these commercials. Show was produced by my man, Philip Nye. Of course, we had Anita on production support. Selwyn gave us live social media views and all those things. And hey, pardon us for not being able to read your messages and opening the phone lines. This conversation was deep, and we're hoping that by the time we come here again next week, we'll probably know who our ministers and the deputies, at least those who have been put forward by the presidency, would be. My name is George Quaye. This has been an exciting edition, or our first edition for 2020 of Showbiz A to Z.